Good evening, I'm Hyde Post. On behalf of the Georgia First Amendment Foundation, I want to welcome you all. This is our 14th annual Weltner Award Banquet. A couple of housekeeping things. We didn't get everybody name tags. They have arrived if you want one. If anybody's still struggling to find which table they're at, you can ask Shawn or Holly or me, or you can just wander around aimlessly and find an empty seat. That's all fine. So a couple of housekeeping things. Another thing that if you didn't check into the at reception outside, we do have parking validation cards. And if you'll see Holly, I guess, or she can direct you to someone who has them. The restrooms are over there. That's another housekeeping thing. First and foremost tonight, I want to thank our sponsors, and our sponsor cards just arrived, and they're also identified in your programs, which you should find on your seats. We wouldn't be able to do this without them, so thank them very, very much. Tonight's a special night in a lot of ways. We get to celebrate some victories on the First Amendment front, and that's always very exciting for us. It's also special you get to witness a changing of the guard, so to speak, anyway. The Georgia First Amendment Foundation has a new president. I've been here way too long. Shawn McIntosh is the deputy managing editor for the Atlanta Journal-Constitution. She's provided guidance and direction on a lot of the best investigative work and reporting that's been done at that paper over the past decade or so that she's been there. She's a longtime member of IRE, the Investigative Reporters and Editors Group, and has been an officer and a leader for them as well. She's always been a strong, passionate supporter of open government and transparency. I've had the opportunity, while I was at the AJC, to work with her for 9 years. And then again, when she joined the foundation, I'm thrilled. I think we have a great leader in Shawn, and I'm thrilled that she's going to be the foundation president, and is the foundation president. She made it a condition of her presidency that I emcee one more of these things, so I'm doing that. She'll be talking after dinner tonight about some new initiatives that we've got underway and some things that we're doing. But first she's going to do what we're all here for, which is really to honor the work. And she'll be presenting our Open Government Hero Award. So please welcome our new president, Shawn McIntosh.
All right, before I do my introduction, I just want to thank Hyde for his 21 years of service as president. Hyde is the Georgia First Amendment Foundation. He founded it, and he's grown it to what it is, and to this wonderful gathering, 14 years of that, and 21 years of fighting for First Amendment values and freedom of information and government transparency in Georgia. So thank you very much for that. Okay, I'm going to give you a little introduction of one of our honored guests tonight. April 18th of 2012 was a very big day for open government in Georgia. At the Atlanta Press Club, Governor Nathan Deal was scheduled to sign a significant rewrite of the laws requiring transparency in Georgia government. Attorney General Owens had pushed the rewrite through, and the coalition he built, which included the Georgia First Amendment Foundation, had agreed on segments to strengthen the law, increase penalties, and address new electronic forms of records. It was a big improvement and a big step for Georgia. There was a little tiny glitch that day. Someone forgot to bring the bill to the press club meeting. So the governor had to stage a signing for the cameras. I'm still thinking he signed a menu. I'm not sure. But at any rate, he went back to the Gold Dome and immediately signed the bill, and it took effect right away. A few hours later, 40 miles up the road, it was a big day for Nydia Tisdale, too. But it was not as good a day. Now, Nydia, if you don't know, films government meetings. They said I have to talk louder, I have to lean in. Nydia films government meetings and other newsworthy events. She's a citizen journalist, and she posts them on the blog she operates, aboutforsyth.com. She calls them Nydios and usually catches the action with a high-quality Sony camera that was a gift from her husband. On that fateful day in April, she was set up to film a meeting of the coming city council. She was standing in the back of the room with her video camera mounted on a tripod when Mayor Ford Gravitt opened the meeting. First of all, he said, a little house cleaning. Chief Tatum, if you would, remove the camera from the auditorium. We don't allow filming in the city hall here unless there are specific reasons. Nydia began to explain the law and to explain that filming with a video camera was perfectly appropriate under Georgia law. And he told her it's not open for discussion. Well, Nydia stood her ground, and a couple of policemen escorted her and her camera out of the room. As she was escorted from the room, she assured the city council that she would file a complaint with the attorney general. She did, and the rest is history. Attorney General Owens won a judgment against Gravitt and Cumming. It's currently under appeal. And Nydia won a $200,000 settlement from the city's insurer in a federal case alleging violations of freedom of speech and other charges. Now, I will tell you, I have had a career of fighting for government transparency and First Amendment freedoms. And it's always been a frustration to me that it's the media who often has to fight for these rights. It's so rare that a private citizen will invest time, money, and skin in the game to force public officials to do what is right. It's so rare. I tell you, Nydia Tisdale is extraordinary. When I got to know Nydia, it didn't really surprise me to learn that she was a copy editor at her college newspaper. The journalists in the room all know that copy editors are those sticklers for the rules. They're the ones that root out the extra comma in your article. They're extremely detail-oriented. Stickler for the rules certainly describes Nydia. She knows the rules of Georgia's open records and open meetings laws, and she knows her rights. I think she's memorized the Red Book. That's the Citizen's Guide to Open Government that we publish. And she's not afraid to quote chapter and verse to public officials. In fact, she hands out red books to public officials. Nydia's path to government activism came through a landfill. Nydia was a property manager for a land investor, and he became concerned when a landfill was proposed next to some property he owned in Forsyth County. Nydia's boss asked her to attend county zoning meetings and monitor the progress of the landfill. As the proposal worked its way through the process, Nydia found more and more concerns with the proposal. She joined an active group in opposing the landfill. When it became clear that the permit was going to be denied, the application for the landfill was withdrawn. And with that victory, Nydia was hooked. She had grown into an activist. Since then, she's filed complaints protesting improper candidate financial disclosures, meetings held without proper public notice. She filed a lawsuit against Cumming for what she thought was an illegal land deal. And then there's that thing at the pumpkin farm. You may have seen the video. Nydia was filming a Republican candidate for him in Dawsonville in 2014 when she was told by an officer with the Sheriff's Department, an off-duty officer, that she had to stop taping. She explained that the meeting was advertised to the public, it included public officials, and she had the property owner's permission. The officer was having none of it. Now, if you know Nydia, you know what happened next. She stood her ground, and the officer dragged her basically from the venue into a barn. She ended up charged with obstructing an officer and trespassing. Attorney General Owens was one of the candidates at the pumpkin farm that day, and he objected to her being dragged off and arrested. If we stand for anything as a party, he said, what are we afraid of with the lady having a camera filming us? What message are we sending? Nydia recently gave notice that she intends to sue the Dawson County Sheriff's Office, several officers, and various other people associated with the event. She's seeking dismissal of the charges against her, as well as a declaration that her rights were violated. I admire Nydia's commitment to fight for her rights and the rights of all citizens in Georgia. I believe that there's too much tolerance for shenanigans and secrecy among public officials in Georgia. At the newspaper, we write all the time about outrageous activity, and readers respond with outrage, but nothing changes. If more citizens channeled a little more Nydia and demanded more of their public officials, Georgia would be a better place to live. Nydia, we're pleased to present you with the Open Government Hero Award on behalf of the Georgia First Amendment Foundation. Thank you for your service to the citizens of Georgia.
That was so touching. Thank you, Shawn McIntosh. That just melts me. As you know, my name is Nydia Tisdale. I live in Roswell, Georgia. I'm a citizen journalist. And many of you I have met or I've seen because I've either filmed you at a public meeting, or you were filming the same meeting that I was filming, or you were covering the same meeting that I was covering. And I have learned so much. I'm not a lawyer, although some people think I might be, and they ask if I am. And one year I signed up to take CLE classes, and I got an annual pass, and I went to as many continuing legal education courses as I could, and I learned about the law, and I learned about my rights. I was given the Red Book, Georgia Sunshine Laws, A Citizen's Guide to Open Government by attorneys Jerry Weber and Holly Mannheimer. This red book changed my life quite literally because I learned that visual and sound recording shall be permitted at open meetings. So I started carrying my camera, which was a gift from my husband, Cooper Tisdale. It's nice to know that some people actually watch my videos. thank you so much for this recognition tonight. You have just really touched my heart. Thank you.
I want to first introduce some of our distinguished guests this evening. If you will, hold up your hand for a moment when I say your name, and if I forget somebody, please forgive me. I'll call your name, and you can look around, and other people can find you afterwards if they want to talk to you. We're very honored tonight to have a former Weltner winner, Supreme Court Justice Carol Hunstein is here. Also from the Supreme Court, Presiding Justice Harris Hines is here. Hold your hand up higher. And Justice David Nahmias is here. From the State Court of Appeals, Judge Ann Elizabeth Barnes is here, and I don't remember which table she's at. Yeah, there she is. And so is State Representative Mary Margaret Oliver is here as well. In addition to our honorees, we have Chief Deputy Attorney General Jeff Milsteen is here, along with several of his Assistant Attorneys General cohorts. Dennis Dunn is here, and I think Russ Willard is here as well. Also, I believe Assistant Secretary of State David Dove is here, and counsel to the Secretary of State, Ryan Germany, is here, I think. We also have a special guest, Cindy Cheatham, who is working with the Georgia First Amendment Foundation as a consultant with the Cox grant that Shawn mentioned. As we look forward, and so we're delighted to have you here, and if you want to find her and tell her everything that we need to know or about how to make this a better organization and serve you better, she's an ideal person and a new ear to bend on the subject. We're also happy to have with us tonight from Justice Weltner's family, his daughter Betsey Weltner is here too. I'm tempted, but I won't share her news. You can ask Betsey what's going on in her life. It's very exciting. Thank you all for coming to be with us. It takes a lot of work to do these dinners, and it's all volunteer work. So please bear with me for a few more well-deserved thank yous. I want to thank the Weltner Committee, Derek Bauer, Tom Budlong, Tom's wife Debbie, Peter Canfield, Carolyn Carlson, Tom Clyde, Ken Foskett, Marianne Marocca, Sean, of course, Dale Russell, and Jerry Weber. They're all members of the committee and worked very hard to make this happen. Dale deserves special thanks for putting together the video that you're going to see here in a little while. And I want to thanks, too, to our volunteer photographer, Laura Lopez Diazua. I may have screwed that up, but thank you very much. And thanks to another Weltner Award winner who always helps us out each year, Mike Lukovich, who, again, did another fabulous drawing. It's great to have Mike's help. Finally, my particular thanks goes to our tireless executive director, Holly Mannheimer. Hold your applause. Holly also has a legal practice, and she's a part-time judge. I am personally so grateful for the many long hours she devotes each year to making this happen. Even more, I'm grateful for having had the opportunity, almost since the inception of the organization, to be guided by her wisdom, to have the opportunity to work with her, for her good humor, to be buoyed by her good humor, and to be energized by her commitment to free speech and to the cause that we serve. The citizens of Georgia, a lot more of them know who she is now than when we began, but not nearly enough. And I think they are exceptionally well served by having Holly as a watchdog for their rights, and the foundation is so fortunate to have her service. Thank you, Holly. Now you can clap. I'm about to turn it over to Shawn to tell you about kind of where we're headed. But I was going to set this up with something that I heard not too long ago on the radio, on a podcast, that I think I offer this up as that it provides kind of an idea of how fast things are changing, not just in the open records arena, but in the open data arena, and how many challenging issues we have before us in dealing with it to make sure that the citizens are well served, that government is well served, that we're all in the service of the First Amendment in a good way. The item that ran, and some of you may have heard it on NPR, was about a company, and let me ask if anybody in this room knows the name of this company. Persistent Surveillance Systems. Has anybody ever heard of them? Okay, back in 2004, there were a lot of casualties in Iraq, as you will recall, from roadside bombs. And there was a guy in the Air Force by the name of Ross McNutt who had a team and an idea. And his idea was, we really need to figure out how this happens and solve this roadside bomb problem. And his solution was a 44 megapixel camera and a plane that would fly around the city where they did this in Iraq and take a picture every second for weeks in this very high resolution camera. And the way that they were able to find and capture or kill terrorists who were setting these roadside bombs is that when a bomb went off, they looked at their data at the place where the explosion occurred. And then they went backwards in time and looked at that same place for the previous 24 hours or the 24 hours before that, until they found someone who actually placed the bomb. Then they followed that person or those people back to where they came from, and then they followed them forward around town where they met other people, but they basically tracked these networks of folks that were setting roadside bombs. And it was very effective. They saved a lot of lives. They caught a lot of terrorists. And now Ross McNutt came back, and he decided to start a private company that does this in the United States. And his thesis was that he could solve crimes, and he probably can. The other side of that coin, of course, is what it might mean for in the realm of kind of Big Brother. You know, there'll be good things that can come out of it, certainly, and they're using it in traffic studies now, but there are also challenges to it as well. And I offer it only as an example of something that is here now and is going to raise some very interesting issues as that kind of technology and that kind of data collection kind of spreads around. And so those are the things, and Shawn will tell you a little bit about what we're doing, but not specifically about this, but about how we feel the need to go forward and some of the issues that we're going to try and see down the road as we move forward as an organization. So with no further ado, I will let you, Shawn, talk to you a little bit about who we are and where we're headed. Thank you.
That's a lot taller than me. Can y'all hear? Okay. All right. I think it's a pretty exciting time for the First Amendment Foundation. It's really extraordinary how much things are changing in the world of government transparency and government data and government records and government communication. The foundation was founded in 1994 on a pretty simple premise that an educated citizenry and an alert citizenry is better able to preserve open government and demand transparency from its leaders. I don't really think the foundation's founders could possibly have envisioned all the ways that that transparency would be challenged. We're in an age now where electronic records move at the speed of light, and the number of government records grows exponentially every day. Everyone does business via text message or email. Conference calls are more common than face-to-face meetings. We have things like Snapchat that disappear 30 seconds after you type into them. Everyone films everything. And drones are standing in for human beings in some government business. You might assume that explosive growth in electronic records and electronic communication would make it faster and easier and more efficient for governments to be transparent. In some ways, that would be a correct assumption, but truthfully, not in many. I find the challenges of an electronic world even more difficult for the First Amendment Foundation to navigate. These new technologies challenge how their challenges in how the information is gathered, disseminated, stored, and distributed. I think the biggest challenge we see over and over again is balancing the concerns for appropriate privacy with freedom of information. It's a lot easier to invade someone's privacy with a computer than it is to go down to the courthouse and spend 6 weeks digging through paper records. So that's a constant balancing act for us. I would say the First Amendment Foundation has never been more essential in Georgia because of this. Here are just some of the questions that your First Amendment Foundation weighs in on regularly. Can or should personal information be stricken from public records? Can state agencies negotiate with private businesses behind closed doors? Should criminal records be expunged and deleted as though they never existed after a sentence is served and a person is rehabilitated? Should television news cameras be allowed in courtrooms? And should citizens be allowed to take out their iPhone and film in courtrooms? How do average citizens access public records that are increasingly stored on computer servers? And are government agencies legally charging legally reasonable fees for public records, or are they abusing the law to be able to withhold these records from the public? What government databases should be readily accessible online? And then some new areas that really have this balance of privacy and transparency. Police body cams, how much of that is public and when? Drone video recorders, if someone flies over your backyard while your 16-year-old daughter is sunbathing, is that a public record? I don't know. What are appropriate practices for record transition for huge volumes of video data that will be generated by these body cameras and government drones? How should police and other officials react when citizens want to take out their camera and film the operations of government. So these questions are changing a lot for us, but our mission is not really changing. Holly and our team are constantly at work educating the public and officials, monitoring the General Assembly to make sure freedoms are not curtailed. I want to mention a couple of emerging new priorities for the First Amendment Foundation that I think will affect us in the short-term future. The first is body cams. The explosive growth in the use of body-worn cameras by police will present a huge array of questions about how these public records are used. We've already partnered up with the Georgia Bureau of Investigation and our friend Vernon Keenan, and Holly and Tom Clyde and I recently met with a group of law enforcement representatives to begin hammering out some best practices on body-worn cameras. I can tell you it's going to be hard work to find consensus in a lot of these areas, but it's really hard to imagine more important work for the First Amendment. The essential purpose of body cameras seems to me to be to increase confidence in the government through transparency. That's really the heart of the Foundation's mission. We expect to develop training for law enforcement and citizens in this important area. Drones. The regulation of drone video filming in use is currently before the FAA. CNN has been approved to test the use of drones for news reporting, and the things they learn could affect drone regulations for all news media. We'll need to stay on top of this as our legislature is likely to offer some regulation of their own. New avenues of training for us. We've already developed some workshops regarding drones and police body cameras. We see lots of opportunity for education programs for the public and for specific groups struggling with emerging technology. I can tell you that Holly and I did some training for law enforcement in Middle Georgia about a month ago about what they should do when a citizen pulls out a cell phone and starts filming police activity. And they're going to need a lot of training, I'm just telling you. Police are under tremendous pressure, and they need to know what's legal and what's not legal and what they can do and cannot do when challenged by a citizen with a camera. Another area we'll be paying a lot of attention to is records costs. In the rewrite of the Open Records Bill, we made some great updates to the segments dealing with electronic records, but I suspect we have more work to do. Just because a record is stored electronically, a citizen should not have to pay a programmer to search for it, a lawyer to review it, and a clerk to print it out and look at it and decide if there's something they want to black out. Yet we get these kind of cost requests all the time, that it involves a programmer and a lawyer and a clerk and a redaction specialist for a simple records request. The process for redacting records is necessary to protect privacy, but it's too opaque, and government agencies are not often skilled enough or up to date enough in retrieving and redacting records to do it efficiently. And I won't say it's all nefarious, but redaction and retrieval costs have increasingly become a barrier to simple records requests. Finally, I would be remiss if I did not mention the operational challenge that your foundation is facing. The explosive growth in electronic communication that I mentioned has challenged our business model. For much of our existence, as you may know, the foundation has served the needs of and been primarily supported by so-called mainstream media in Georgia, particularly newspapers. And as newspapers and other mainstream media work to reinvent themselves in a new media landscape, many have lowered their level of support for our organization. We believe this change presents the First Amendment Foundation with an opportunity. We think we can recalibrate our mission and programs to meet a new and broader audience. We've received a generous grant from the James M. Cox Foundation for strategic planning and capacity building, and as Hyde mentioned, we're working with Cindy Cheatham on our strategic plan. If you have ideas or you want to be involved in our work, we welcome you. It's the most challenging and intellectually stimulating work I can imagine right now. And let me or Holly know if you're interested. As I said, our work is vital and becoming more so. So we very, very much appreciate all your support. We couldn't do this work without you. Thank you very much.
Sorry, don't know where it
dollars.
We have to make sure that our video will play, which is always a challenge because the computer always goes to sleep. So.
There you go.
Okay. To introduce the video about our honoree tonight, we're most fortunate to have with us Presiding Justice Harris Hines. Like our honoree, he was educated here at Emory. Like our honoree, he's got deep roots in Cobb County, where he was a state court judge and a superior court judge before being nominated to the Supreme Court by Zell Miller back in 1995. I used to see Justice Hines fairly regularly during high school years because our kids were both at Marietta High School during the same period. His son Hap, as some of you will recall, went on to have a lot of success as a kicker for the University of Georgia. As challenging as the Supreme Court can be, and it is quite challenging, I have no doubt, I'm not sure it can ever match the anxiety that a parent would feel when your son has a clutch field goal attempt to try and make before 90,000 screaming Georgia fans. I had enough trouble just getting my kid through driver's ed, but he's a great justice and a man of great humor and humility. Please welcome Justice Harris Hines. When you're ready to either call me or you have to do that.
Hyde, I don't know how to do that. Can I just give you this?
Just give me a thumbs up and I'll come do it.
I'm going to put these papers down on this, and if I just black out everything, I want to apologize up front. Okay, I'll do that. Okay. Hi, thank you for those remarks, and let me just say a little bit about, first of all, Helen told me this. As I always get up, this is always, I know my wife is going to say this, and I have not been proven wrong in umpteen years. Don't try to be funny, Harris Hines, because you're not, okay? So I talked to my friend Bill Barwick coming in. He says, have you got a joke? And I said, you know, I really thought I had one or two, but Helen doesn't think they're very funny, and so I'm going to go on. I will tell you this, Hyde and other ladies and gentlemen, when we talk about if you think somebody knows you as a lawyer or a judge or a justice, they don't know you anywhere compared to being a football player at the University of Georgia. Several years ago, I was in South Georgia to speak at a lawyer's little gathering that night, and a fella comes up to me, and says, I know you. Don't I know you? Yeah, I know you. Says, you're Hap Hines' father, aren't you? And I said, obviously, being a football player was a lot more than being a judge in the state of Georgia. The other thing, when Hyde talks about your tummy hurting when your son is out there kicking field goals, Hap, after one game, he had kicked a 54-yard field goal, a long one. He says, Dad, do you want to come out after the Sanford Stadium and just see how the goalposts look from where you kick? And I said, sure, I'll walk out there. Ladies and gentlemen, I will say this. If you go out and walk on a football field and look at a 54-yard field goal, the uprights look like a paperclip. They look like they're about that small. I'm glad I did not know that earlier on his career because I don't believe we'd have made it. This is a true story, and then I'll go from there. Hyde, you talk about being nervous at Sanford Stadium. We're playing LSU at Baton Rouge at night. Now, we eventually win. We play them twice, once in Athens, once in Baton Rouge. We win by 1 point each time, so every kick is important. Helen and I are walking in that night. We had on our Georgia togs. And you talk about getting abused just walking in a stadium. I didn't say anything to anybody, but they were not friendly to us. Let me just put it like that. a lot of it was polysyllabic. I'll put it like that, and I go from there. But anyway, We're down there, and Georgia is coming down the field, and we're sitting in the end zone. That's where, you know, we've got our seats. And we can almost see them breathing, and it's getting close to a big kick. And Helen turns to me, and she says, "I'm out of here." And I said, "Darling, please, please don't leave me now. Please don't leave me." So she didn't. But I will say this, that was the last time she ever saw him kick a ball. From then on, there was a big fella sat next to us in the Athens Stadium, and Helen would just hold his arm during the game, and when he kicked, he'd just bury his arm in his shoulder, and he'd pat her on the shoulder and say, "It was good, Ms. Hines, it was good." So, well, as I said, that's about the only funny things I can say, and I'm running out of that. Why I appreciate the opportunity to introduce your recipient of the Weltner Award for many reasons. Number one, when I became a Superior Court judge in Cobb County, Georgia, I was sworn in by then Justice Weltner. He was on he was actually a judge of the Superior Court of the Atlanta Judicial Circuit at that time, but Justice Weltner was kind enough to come out and swear me in. Now, I always thought I was kind of one of his favorites till I got reversed by him one time as a trial judge when he was on the bench. And this was a case, I don't know if y'all remember, but one of the real big items years ago in Georgia was the big banks versus the little banks. We're going to statewide banking. And I mean, it was a war in the legislature and everything. And this case comes out, and Ms. Susan Cahoon, I remember from the Kilpatrick firm, was representing one of the interests. And they had a statute which I didn't think made a whole lot of sense, but it was pretty clear to me what it said, okay? And so in ruling on that, we have a precedent called stare decisis. You know, you follow the precedent unless it would just give you a really ridiculous outcome. So I rule in this, and it's appealed to the Georgia Supreme Court. Now, one of your former recipients is also Chief Justice Norman Fletcher. And he was on that, and he told me this years after this, he said, "When I come on the bench up there, I got reversed. The opinion was written by Justice Weltner." And he told me, Justice Fletcher said, "Harris," said, I really thought I was going to be able to sustain you, and you were going to carry the day in that opinion." He says, "The first time it came to the court," says, "Justice Weltner was not there, and we kind of took a TD vote, a tentative decision vote," and he said, "It was 7-0 in your favor, but it was 6-0 in your favor, but Justice Weltner wasn't there," so they bring it back, and it comes back, and he convinces five of them, he said four of them, to go with him, so it was 5-2. Justice Fletcher wrote the dissent opinion in my favor. Now, this is what it was. I have been waiting ever since then to say this as an appellate judge, but I haven't had the right case. But you can't say this as a trial judge, because you just can't go out. But Justice Weltner had this statute, and it was pretty clear. But he needed a way to get around it, and he was facing, you know, stare decisis precedent. And I will never forget these words in the opinion, which are just beautiful. He says, "The trial court has relied on a statute which is a vestigial remainder totally devoid of substance." And I thought, man, that's a great way to say it, you know. Says that, but it's just a vestigial remainder totally devoid of substance. So that was it. But it was a treat. Now, I'm going to ask a question now, and this because all of you ladies and gentlemen, distinguished journalists, be it print, broadcast, video, or what, do you all know a question? I have a question for you now. Do you all know a county that in 1974 had three persons running for local office? One is an executive branch of government, one is the legislative branch of government, and one in a judicial branch of government, who then later went on to hold those branches in statewide office. Does anybody know the county? 1974. General Olens, I'm sure you know. I'm giving you the thing. Do you know the Cobb County? That's right. Now, does anybody perchance know those three persons? All right, I'm going to give y'all a hint. I'm going to give you two things. Two of them are former recipients of the Weltner Award. Governor Barnes, Senator Isaacson, and little old Harris Hines was running for a judgeship. So we've been friends since then. In 1974, Senator Isaacson was running for the Eastern District Commissioner. Later, Governor Barnes, he was then running for the state Senate, and I was running for a state court at that time. We've been friends ever since that time. They've come to my house for breakfasts, and Sam Owens has also been a friend of mine, and we all have that in common, so it's a treat to do this. So let me just say this. Mr. Hyde, ladies and gentlemen, other members of the Georgia First Amendment Foundation, it's my pleasure and privilege to introduce and present to you Sam Owens, who was sworn in as Georgia's 53rd Attorney General on January the 10th, 2011. In that same year, he worked with legislators to strengthen the penalties for sex trafficking, making Georgia's law one of the toughest in the nation. And in 2012, he spearheaded the first comprehensive revision of Georgia's sunshine laws in more than a decade. He has represented our state in crucial litigation to preserve our water rights and to remove legal barriers that were delaying the critically needed deepening of the Savannah Harbor. General Owens currently is chair of the Southern Region of the National Association of Attorneys General and is co-chair of its Federalism Preemption Committee. Prior to being elected Georgia's Attorney General, he was chairman of the Cobb County Board of Commissioners, serving from August 2002 through March 2010. General Owens is the recipient of numerous awards and honors, including the 2013 Emory Law School Distinguished Alumni Award and the 2007 Excellence in Public Service Award by the University of Georgia's Carl Vinson Institute. For the past 11 years, Georgia Trend Magazine has listed General Owens as one of the 100 most influential Georgians. And in 2011, the Cobb Chamber of Commerce honored General Owens for his dedication to community and philanthropic service by naming their annual Community Service Award the Sam Owens Business Community Service Award. General Owens graduated from the Emory University School of Law in 1983. And is admitted to practice law in Georgia and the District of Columbia. General Owens and his wife, Lisa, his gracious wife, Lisa, have two children, Lauren and Jonathan. Let me say this about General Owens, who is a friend of mine, and I have known Sam well, and I know Sam well. I would say that the dominant characteristic of some of our exceptional leaders is probably a superior intellect. And Sam Owens is as bright as a new penny. And for still others, I would say it is a heightened sense of energy. And Sam has a full measure of that gift. But I think our best leaders are at their core good, decent people. Sam Owens is one of those leaders. Sam likes people. He wants to help people, and he wants to serve people. And the result, Sam Owens has our trust and our appreciation. Mr. Hyde, ladies and gentlemen of the Georgia First Amendment Foundation, it's my pleasure to present to you Samuel S. Owens, the Attorney General of the State of Georgia.
It's easy to see how much Sam Owens has accomplished as an adult. Attorney, commissioner, prosecutor, and family man. But it's often said our personalities that drive us to success are forged in childhood. You might think Sam Owens' childhood is no different than most. You might be wrong. Born in South Florida, the youngest of three, Sam Owens was dealt a cruel blow at an early age. Sam's wife, Lisa.
And when he was 5 years old, his mother died of a heart attack.
His widower father moved the family hundreds of miles north to Vineland, New Jersey. A quintessential post-war America town, with a main street dotted with mom and pop shops and surrounded by farmland.
It's a very kind of rural area, farmland, a lot of chickens, and Sam's family had a bakery.
One of those Landis Avenue shops was Liss Bakery. Sam's aunt and uncle ran the Jewish bakery, serving up bagels, challah, Sam's favorite crumb cake, and lessons that have lasted him a lifetime.
He talks about the valuable lessons he learned from his family about giving back, and where, once again, they didn't have great means of their own, but they had this bakery, and rather than take the leftovers and sell them, you know, half price the next day, they would donate them to kind of a comparable to a soup kitchen or food bank.
Sam put those lessons to work at an early age, gaining self-satisfaction and a bit of early success helping others as a young crossing guard. But then, another tragic turn of events. At 12, his father died of a heart attack.
And I think it's hard for him to be close to people just because he's lost so many people that he's been close with. And so I think that has probably impacted him.
Sam would now be raised by his aunt and uncle. 2 years later, his uncle died.
It clearly has shaped him. On the surface, I'd say that perhaps he can be somewhat cynical at times, but I think that's kind of a defensive mechanism. But I think also he's very much about focusing on the important things.
And one of the important things for the young Olens, work. He started his own garden outside his family's tiny apartment and picked up the first of what would be many press clippings in his future. He worked his way through high school and later college, doing a variety of odd jobs from slopping through a chicken processing plant.
Surprisingly, he still eats chicken.
To mastering everything at McDonald's, spinning records as a nightclub DJ, and doing quality control at a glass factory.
I don't think he had a clue what he was doing. I kind of envision it like I Love Lucy, where Ethel and Lucy are in the chocolate factory line. And
here she comes!
That was not a lasting career either.
Perhaps that eye for flaws helped Sam through undergraduate school, postgraduate work, and finally law school. He married and started a family. Lauren and Jonathan were his and Lisa's pride and joy. Turns out, serious Sam was the easier-going parent.
I'd be the one that'd say, be the straighter one, and so he'd be the one who can kind of let loose with the kids more and be the goofier one.
Family and his law practice were his primary focus. Politics was the last thing on his mind.
Never had a conversation about it, never any interest. It just never was in the cards.
But then he joined the East Cobb Civic Association, which led to running for Cobb County Commission, then Commission Chairman. And 8 years later, Sam Olens, the man who wanted nothing to do with politics, was elected Attorney General of Georgia. One of the core components of his campaign platform was to improve Georgia's open records laws, and he did. In his own way.
I was very impressed at how he brought all the players to the table. The fact that he worked with the First Amendment Foundation, that he worked with members of the media, as opposed to the way things normally go down at the state capitol, where it's all done behind closed doors and you're given a product right before it's voted on.
Signed into law in 2012, the Georgia Open Records Act had an improved section on computer records and stronger enforcement provisions and stiffer penalties.
We moved the camera from the auditorium.
Those new penalties were soon tested.
This is an open and public meeting.
A citizen journalist, Nydia Tisdale,
I have a right by Georgia law to film this meeting.
Was forced out of City Hall by Mayor Ford Gravett. Seems he didn't like her videotaping an open meeting.
Yes,
Sam Olens stepped in. Backing up Ms. Tisdale in court, Olens won, and a judge ordered defendants to pay $12,000 in penalties. State Senator Josh McCoon.
He has aggressively gone after people who have violated these sunshine laws and held them accountable. And so I think it's entirely appropriate to recognize him for being a champion of open, transparent government.
Tonight, the First Amendment Foundation is pleased to award the 2015 Charles L. Weltner Freedom of Information Award to Sam Olens. From citizen farmer to cultivator of laws that have impacted the lives of every Georgian.
Attorney General Owens, on behalf of my family, I would like to present you with the Charles Longstreet Weltner Freedom of Information Award and to thank you, Attorney General, for your commitment to open government.
So first, I want to thank Dale for that. God, I have not seen pictures like that in a long time of Vineland, New Jersey. Want to thank Justice Hines and Helen for being here and for the justice's great words. Of course, thank my wife. I learned early on that you can't do anything without your wife's support. And this summer, we celebrated our 30th anniversary, so you know she is a very patient woman. We have the opportunity when confronted with challenges to either look them in the eye and move forward or to pity yourself as a result of it. And I've always had the honor to have folks that worked with me to improve lives and to improve our community. And I'm grateful for all those individuals. You know, it's my honor to receive this award. When I've been to numerous other annual programs, seen Betsey at numerous annual programs. Congratulate Betsey, by the way, she's getting married really soon. So we're proud of you and congratulations. But I had the opportunity to, as Shawn was saying, go on the internet and see some of the new technology, shall we say. So I researched a little bit about Justice Weltner. About his service to our state, why the award is named after him. And it was very, very telling that the Georgia First Amendment Foundation has their award after Justice Weltner because he was an unbelievable man, an unbelievable jurist, in a time where few would ever think of having the courage that he displayed. Also, it has been my good fortune to work with the Georgia First Amendment Foundation. I actually remember before I ever met with Holly, I was in the room in the campaign in 2010 with the HAC, and they were asking me what kind of things I wanted to do, and Shawn pretty much told me I was crazy to think we were going to play with the rewrite of the Sunshine Laws. But 2 years later, I convinced her that we were going to do it, and it occurred. You know, Martin Luther King once declared that the time is always right to do what is right, and Chief Justice Weltner followed that tenet each and every day. When he was a congressman, he was the only Georgia congressman to vote for the Civil Rights Act of 1964. Now, we can imagine the guts that that took, the integrity of the gentleman, and the fact that he was going to do what was right, even if he was in a very lonely space. He also chose not to run for re-election when he refused to sign the Democratic pledge to support all Democratic candidates because he refused to support Lester Maddox, an avowed segregationist, as the Democratic candidate for governor. I would suggest to you that in my X years of politics, I've never met someone who had that type of integrity and courage. That just doesn't really exist. I've met many mentors, many outstanding elected officials and public officials, but the idea of saying I'm not running for re-election, the idea of saying I'm going to be the only Georgian to vote on an issue like the Civil Rights Act is rather amazing. His service on the Superior Court was, of course, stellar before he went to the Supreme Court. As I was looking on the internet, I saw a prior talk I was mentioning to Betsey by the Chief Judge of the Northern District of Georgia, Tom Thrash, known Tom for years and years, lives in Vinings. And Tom stated that Justice Weltner represented courageous public service, a man of honesty, integrity, and principle. and he certainly did. As many of you know, when I became the 53rd Attorney General of the state, we sought to change the Sunshine Laws. It was not easy. It took a lot of meetings. It took a lot of discussions. It took a lot of food. It took a lot of effort, and many, many folks were invaluable in that exercise, getting the, as William talked about, getting the stakeholders at the table, bringing people together. Holly, who we applauded earlier tonight, was invaluable in that process. Shawn was invaluable. David Hudson, great, great gentleman out of Augusta. Tom Clyde, Cynthia, numerous folks really helped from the interest of the press in helping us get that done. And even when they would agree to changes, they'd stay through the process to make the bill stronger. In fact, I remember one day where Shawn, Cynthia, Tom, and Holly were ready to pretty much strangle a couple members of the General Assembly and the Judiciary Reviews Committee. And Tom made it known that he wanted three revisions and he wasn't leaving. Actually, he wanted four and he wasn't leaving. He walked out with three. The only one he didn't get was really, really puny. It was a really minor one. And, you know, he had to have the little face of, you know, I should have gotten all four. And then about 10 minutes later, he admitted to us that, boy, that went a lot better than he ever thought. And at that point, we made it known that when it went to the state Senate, we wanted no amendments. We just wanted a clean vote, and we were lucky to get that clean vote. I also, as an aside, of course, greatly appreciate the foundation and the and Mike Luckovich for his caricature. But I think what makes it even more special is when I first talked to Shawn and other members of the press, I said, you know, y'all spend all this energy on the Open Records Act, and where the real mischief lies is the Open Meetings Act. That when you go to a public meeting and there's 40 items at the meeting and they're out in 20 minutes, you weren't at the right meeting. So it's cute looking at the caricature because that's clearly of an open meeting, which of course fits with Nydia rather than open records. Our office is going to continue to be vigilant. We're going to continue to work to enforce the laws to assure accountability. And I work with great folks each and every day that do that. So first, of course, I want to congratulate Nydia. A few folks have her courage and do what she does day in and day out. So we always have to assume when we're speaking, we're being filmed. We always have to assume that we are supposed to think before we speak. And if we're afraid of someone filming us, maybe we shouldn't be speaking because we don't have the right things to say. And of course, I want to thank the great lawyers that I work with at the Department of Law. And of course, the chief deputy is here. Dennis Dunn, who I had the honor of going to law school with, we graduated the same year. I won't say how old you are, Dennis. Russ Willard, who's now the section head of that unit. Jennifer Colangelo and Amanda Jones do a great job for us. And before them, Stefan Ritter, who now heads the Ethics Commission. And Kelly Campanella spent a lot of time dealing with the Sunshine Laws, making sure that everyone had a level playing field and that the law would be followed. And our role as defenders of the Sunshine Laws, we get to assist everyday citizens, which is really neat, to not just represent the government, but to represent everyday citizens against public officials and governmental bodies who seek to abuse their power. Let me suggest to you that I'm still not really liked by certain members of ACCG and GMA, et cetera, who think I turned on them when we went through this process. But as Chief Justice Weltner stated in Davis versus City of Macon, public officials must conduct the public's business out in the open. And we as the Department of Law strive to ensure that the public's business is indeed conducted according to the Sunshine Laws we've strengthened and enforced. All of you, of course, are familiar with Justice Brandeis's saying that sunlight is the best of disinfectant. Well, thanks to the work of the Georgia First Amendment Foundation, thanks to the work of the great lawyers I have the honor of working with each and every day, Georgia citizens do enjoy the sunshine of open meetings and open records, and public officials are held accountable to the very people who have elected them. God bless you, and thank you very much for the honor.